My first, well, it's not really a question, obviously, it's more of a comment, but Bernard, wonderful, thank you all of you for your wonderful talks there. Amanda, you were talking about your research with the psilocybin and how the effects of that on the brain, and counterintuitively, it seems that the centres in the brain are less active, which is reminiscent of Aldous Huxley's notion the brain is a reducing valve for the mind, so that the brain works as a filter to filter out all the kind of information people are experiencing from the universe directly through their senses or through possibly other means. And an interesting anecdotes about that is that people experimenting with DMT, which is a close analog of psilocybin, is 5-HO DMT, and I've put this to you before, Bernard, people talk about experiencing space and extra dimensions of space and time, so experiencing kind of multiple dimensional space, multiple geometrical percepts. I was wondering if it might be possible if we actually somehow switch off the brain, we can get into kind of higher level thinking, Bernard. Anybody?
Well, maybe I could just make one point. I mean, I talked about these extra dimensions in the first part of my talk, and I talked about the necessity to have an expanded view of physics which can talk about mental experience. And I will just tell you what I have a particular favourite approach, which is that these extra dimensions actually provide a method of description of these experiences. You remember the view of the physical world we have is that it's a brain, B-R-A-N-E, in this high-dimensional bulk. But the question is, what else exists in this bulk? And my favourite idea, it's very heretical, but hopefully there are no other physicists here, is that actually mental experiences can be contained in this high-dimensional space, that all these mental, psychic, spiritual experiences require some form of space, but it's a high-dimensional space. It's not the ordinary three-dimensional space. And because that's a feature of these experiences. They seem to take place in a space. It's not the normal space, but it's a space. And so I like the idea that the extra dimensions, which are already provided by physics, can actually accommodate mental experience. And that's why I refer to this new paradigm. I have to say that this is not a main view in physics. In fact, if some of my M-theorist friends heard me saying this, I would be burnt at the stake.
Thank you very much, everybody. I've very much enjoyed your presentations. There seems to be an underlying assumption that an enhanced or expanded consciousness is a good thing. I'd like to question that, both from the personal point of view and from the universal point of view. Personally, I can definitely attest to the fact I've had some great times and I've had some bad times on trips that I've had. But also, my observation is that as we know more, we are not necessarily happier. Would you like to comment?
Well, my father, who was a German, very conservative German businessman, he said, when I was talking to him about the research we were doing on expanding consciousness, he said, well, I don't want to expand my consciousness. I have enough trouble dealing with it as it is. And that would just be expanded problems. But I think that question, you know, consciousness expands and contracts all the time. So it's not limited to drugs. When you woke up this morning, you expanded your consciousness. We have many expansions and contractions all the time. That's normal. We narrow our focus, we focus on one thing, then we expand it again, we take in the whole picture. We do it daily, thousands of times.
I mean, I was certainly not arguing that, expansion of consciousness necessarily led to happiness, but it just seems to be part of, programmed into the cosmos, the evolution of consciousness. In every sense, in the intellectual sense as well as this experiential sense, seems to be part of programmed into the cosmos. Now, I'm not saying that's good or bad. It just seems to be. I like to think evolution is good, but after all, if we all end up destroying ourselves or whatever, I guess you could argue it wasn't good. But I just take it as axiomatic that consciousness, because consciousness is a fundamental rather than incidental feature of the universe. I'm assuming it's ultimately good, but I mean, that's only an assumption.
Let me take the bull by the horns. Everybody hits exactly this point, as long as one assumes that consciousness is no thing. It can be looked at as an energy. Now, I'm a hardcore scientist, engineer, also by a doom-doom. What is energy? Energy is the ability to do work of one kind or another. And that's electrical, magnetic. They can all be measured, gravity, by the amount of work that can be done. What work does consciousness do as an energy? It produces the visions and use of form inside a human being. And once you can work with form, that's generally called consciousness, but it's a specific kind. Now, there's a higher energy than consciousness, which Comrade Freud, because he was a hypnotist and cocainist, and then he forbade that to all his students, which gave him the big advantage, pointed out that there's a higher energy, that it has more energy to do work than the ability to see form, i.e. sexual, creative energy, which also has a creative, destructive aspect to it. Now, ancient initiates proposed that there were two levels of energy above that. One is erotic, but erotic eros had the ability, the energy, to create and destroy. Let's say Elizabeth the Great had the ability to create a New England and destroy the old one. The erotic energy, under these definitions, is the energy required to activate a school that has the energy to actually change history. There's an energy that can be at least put out hypothetically above that, which is transcendent energy. That is the energy that the human body can transcend all of the effects of the previous ones. This is asserted to be true of certain individuals in human history. That is, they can not only go past the energy to do work of putting together a creative destruction, but actually set up a new goal factor that has actually transcend all the previous forms, all the previous creation destructions there. These transcendent points, of course, are obviously exceedingly rare. Anyway, if you look at these as energies, that is gives away then, without an energy is not a thing. So sort of the assumption that consciousness doesn't exist is just not a thing. I totally agree with that. I've never seen any evidence it's a thing. But it has the ability to do work that it has.
I think on a kind of practical level, there are different types of consciousness, and the consciousness of modern man has specialized because of the repression system within the brain. It's specialized in word-controlled thought patterns, which is using one particular circuitry of the brain more than others, which form an inhibition on the free flow of energy and perception. And that by altering that perception so that we get a wider perception, maybe more like an animal's perception or a god's or whatever, we gain a different viewpoint. And I think gaining different viewpoints has a great advantage in getting a better decision. So I would say, from what I know, that to be able to pull in different aspects, different types of consciousness, is an advantage.
The more complex the system, it is true, in principle, there is the greater potentiality for chaos. Okay, but the great thing that nonlinear dynamics has taught us is that actually, despite that, you get the formation of more complicated, of higher level emergent structures which arise out of this system. So in some sense, when you look at that pyramid of complexity, at every stage you might have said, well, the more complicated it is, the more chaotic it could become. But the whole point about our understanding now of chaotic systems is that you do get emergent structures. And in some sense, that's why you always talk about chaos and complexity going together, because the two things go together. But in some sense, the emerging structures tend to work out, at least if you've got the right sort of equations or the right sort of conditions. Of course, it's always true when you look at the human race and you look at the things we're doing, you could well say, well, we're chaotic rather than emergent system. And it is certainly true, you know, every time, even when you expand your knowledge of science, there's always the great danger that you're just gonna, it will end up destroying us. But there's, nevertheless, there is the potential that it's going to be progressive rather than regressive. And so the impression I tend to get is that you've got both possible outcomes, a positive one or a negative one, but if the conditions are right, the positive one is the one that eventually wins out. But we could, of course, destroy ourselves, but we hope that our wisdom in some sense is going to overcome those negative factors.
I want to ask any one of you, where would you place experiences of the dead or deathbed visions and this kind of phenomena in terms of consciousness?
My most recent book, The Life Cycle of the Human Soul, I talk about birth and pre-birth experiences and death and after-death experiences. And I'm a social scientist. I'm an empiricist, so I gather evidence from other people's experiences. And same thing with drug experiences. And experiences are evaluated, you know, like any other reported observation. This is an attitude of radical empiricism, what William James formulated over 100 years ago. He said radical empiricism means you go by observation. Radical empiricism means you don't exclude any observations from your ranges of perceptions from your science. So you include everything as an experience. So people do report memories from the prenatal existence. They report near-death experiences. There are reports of people communicating with the dead. In fact, communicating with the dead is extremely common. A study was done in the 70s, I think, a social survey study was done in the United States where widows or widowers were asked if they had had communication with their deceased spouse. 80% of them said yes, they had. Now, according to our worldview, that shouldn't be possible, because according to the standard worldview, when you're dead, you cease to exist. So who are they talking with? And yet the experience contradicts that, you see. So I think communication with the dead is extremely common. And in the 19th century, there were people that specialized in communicating to the dead. We called them mediums. And nowadays we call them channels, you know, channels, but they also communicate with higher level spirits, higher dimensional spirits, cosmic beings and so forth, and then bring it down to the level of where human beings can hear it and communicate, listen to it.
Of course, I suppose most scientists now, certainly most brain scientists, take the view that consciousness is just an epiphenomena of the brain. You know, they take the reductionist view that it's just like the excreta of the brain, and therefore when the brain dies, the consciousness goes. But there is the other view, and I don't actually think anything we've really heard about this afternoon necessarily goes against that view. But what I personally am interested, I'm interested in parapsychology, and one of the interesting aspects of that is that it suggests that consciousness isn't just excretion of the brain. This is what something David referred to, the filter theory, which says in some sense consciousness is actually more fundamental than matter. Consciousness is merely perceiving the world through the brain. Mm. And that so where there is a big consciousness with a big C, and the universe observes itself wherever there's brains and eyes or whatever. And of course that is not the conventional view, but I would say that if you look at the evidence from psychical research, and especially from the evidence for possible post-mortem communication, that does suggest that consciousness is not just the result of the brain. You know, that it's the filter theory, if you like.
I once did a research with someone, a very high-level meditator, who'd meditated for 40 years, in a MEG machine, which is a kind of latest toy in the brain imaging world. And she was very much wanting to collaborate with the science and see what happened when you really meditate high meditation. And she afterwards told me she had a mystical experience, the best she'd had for many years. She's at the top of a spiritual group in the machine. And interestingly, that showed as a turning off of all the normal parts of the brain, which are activated in normal sense, but a bursting of gamma activity in the left cerebellum, which is a very kind of low part of the brain. And to me, that's rather beautiful, because but it's just one person, but if it's so, because I agree, I think different states, the brain is a recepting machine which receives, but we normally have so many inhibitions that we're unable to receive these subtler forms of consciousness. Whereas she had this burst of activity in, it's rather like a lizard in the sun. She was in perfect bliss, and her cerebellum was glowing with activity. And I think that's just, we don't use our brains to receive these more subtle messages because we've got these incredibly active filtering mechanisms which don't let us get to those perceptions.
See, I'd like to say one other thing about that, which is, has to do with the notion of karma. And I think the Christianity used to have the belief in reincarnation, as do all other religions of the world and all other original primordial religions, take it for granted that this life is not a singular life. It was in the Council of Nicaea around the 4th century that the church adopted the view of reincarnation, which was part of Christianity before that time, and is what's the result of that? It was, I believe, a political power maneuver, because it said, well, it doesn't, there's no accounting after death. You have to account for all of your actions in this life. See, Buddhists, you listen to Tibetan Buddhists, and they will say, I think a lot about my future karma. So if you know you have future karma, you don't escape your karma by dying, you see. And it would be very motivating to pay attention to this life and do what you want do in this life. But the church said, no, you're going to be judged at the end of this life. Either you go to heaven or you go to hell. Those are the two choices. Maybe purgatory, if you're lucky, you get in between for a long time. And that forced everybody then to pay attention and pay your dues and do right and follow the rules like that. In the Buddhist, they don't have, Hindu religions, they don't have that kind of thing. Karma will take care of it, you see. There's no sin and like that. It's consequences. So I think it's important to consider that point of view. Reincarnation and understanding of many lifetimes was always part of humanity's goal. I think it was one of the most immoral actions committed in the collective spiritual consciousness of the West. And it's limited to the West. It's not shared by all cultures worldwide, including third world countries, places like Brazil and everywhere.
In certain states, it's possible to ask a question in the state and ask for refinement in the state. I think Bob Masters did work on plenary states of consciousness with someone being induced into these states. And I'm asking Ralph initially if he can expand on the use of a question and dialoguing with the state or a higher...
Questions, I think, are... to me, questions are more interesting than answers. Answers is like you finish the book and you put it on the shelf. Questions means you're still looking, you're searching around. Well, what is this? What causes this? You see, and science is like that. You have one question after another. Experiment is a systematic way of asking questions. So I think there's a very interesting statement that we sometimes make, a thought that we have. I ask myself. Do you ever say that? I ask myself. You say that thought, that implies that you believe that there's something in you that knows more than you do, right? Otherwise, why would you be asking yourself if you didn't think there was a higher self that was more knowledgeable? You wouldn't do it. So in that question, you intentionally connect yourself to your higher, more knowing self, more wise self. It's very interesting. I read an interview with Obama. Obama, before he became the president, I almost said Osama. Names are so close. It's kind of weird. You know? It's really weird. Isn't it that their names are so close? One letter different? I mean, what is that? But I didn't want to go there. And he said in the interview, it was a very interesting interview with a Chicago religion editor, and where he talked at length about his religious beliefs. And he said, well, you know, I don't, really meditate regularly anymore. I don't have the time as a politician. But one of the things I do is, like, from time to time, I'm going from one meeting to another, I ask myself, what is really my intention behind this encounter that I'm about to engage in? And I thought that was really interesting, because then he's checking, okay, what's my intention, you see? Where am I going? And this is a really good one. It's like becoming aware of your intention, what you're doing. And do you really want to be doing that? You might decide, well, I'm not. I don't want to go to this meeting, see? I don't want to talk to that person. Maybe I'll change my mind right here before it even happens. So that was what I would say to that question.
Yeah, I mean, just to back up, I mean, I was talking about science as a journey, you know, to the outer and inner domains, but it's a quest. The whole point about science is that our picture is always always changing. Science never comes to a final solution. Every paradigm eventually gives way to the next paradigm. So, as Ralph was saying, it's the question which is important. The quest is what's important, and we don't know we'll ever reach the destination. And in some sense, I think we half hope we never get there, because it's the journey which is the fun. And if we ever get to the top of Everest, well, then you've lost the challenge. So the question is absolutely crucial and more important. And every time you answer one question, in science, you always find that it opens up more questions than you've answered.
I'd like to also thank David Luke very much for sharing with us today. Is here from lifeartsmedia.com. They're documenting this event for us. And also we have Resonance FM radio station, which will be doing an edited program sometime in the near future. Thank you.